steps to the back to work at his no-hitter. On the last of today's baseball on CTV. Today's Stieb will work till the seventh inning. He is no-hitter intact at the top of the Cleveland order. He is off just two. Cole got one of those walks to start the game. Nair to the other. They were both erased but attempted steals. Since the walk to Baerga, he is retired an even dozen in succession.
You can tell what he has working for him, just one fly ball out to the outfield.
That is ball one. He's within one strikeout of his season high nine. His career high is 12 against the Chicago White Sox, August 22nd, 88. 1-1 to Alex Cole.
These are the types of hitters that put pressure on a pitcher and the infield. When a no-hitter's being picked, because you know as an infielder that Cole's going to get down the line quickly, you're going to have to hurry with the play.
Strike two. Olin has completed his mission down the bullpen for the Indians, and Jesse Orozco. Pitch misses down in 2-2.
Good evening.
battling, they have the opportunity to wear the glasses. The catcher doesn't. Even though Skinner was standing in the shade, he had to look up into that bright sky. Still was able to make the catch.
Well, the Yankees can still be tough. They haven't shown that against the Red Sox this weekend, losing 15-1 yesterday. It'll be in September as the roster goes away.
Pitcher who got blasted in that ball game against Boston yesterday at Fenway.
He's up and inside the park home run on a shot out into right field clock. Jesse Barkley with a full muscle. He couldn't recover, couldn't get to the ball and play out.
Andy Hawkins has had three starts at Fenway Park, has totaled one inning in the three starts, 13 hits and 18 runs. Trip next year, wherever he is.
The ball of two strikes to Brandon, hitting with one dot, the Blue Jay in ninth.
Tony took a big turn at first base after driving this ball hard into the outfield. He wanted to put a little pressure on Alex Cole, but Cole came up. Fired it in quickly because of the big turn. Baerges saw it. Looked it over the first, see if he could catch Tony going back.
He's there for Kelly Gruber, who walked in the first inning, but hasn't been able to pick up on his success of last night, his home run and double. He's grounded out of fly down to the one. Orozco, soft toss to Jacoby. Way outside, it's 2-2.
hitter.
Plenty of time to get Tony. Two outs. Not a good day for base dealers this afternoon.
No, it hasn't been. The strong arm of Skinner. Look at that throw. Something on it. No chance for Tony Fernandez. In his limited time, Joel Skinner now has tossed out 8 of 17.
Scheduled to face them in the Cleveland 8 on the Mets Blue Jays baseball on CTV.
Looking for a 17th
birthday. Another opportunity for a no-hitter in the 8th inning. Ken Phelps, Buck Jacoby, and Carlos Baerga. And the Indians scheduled to try to disrupt that.
We talked earlier about Dave's longest outing this year, that shutout back on May 28th is the Oakland Athletics.
Distraction factor a little bit. Steve not worried about him. That is in left field.
second strike to Snyder's last time up. He questioned the call of Coble and then struck out swinging on the next pitch and still looked back to be up. So he hasn't forgotten about it.
May not get him any new consideration here either.
The only way you're going to help yourself is if you go up there and say, yeah, I saw the replay. They told me it was a pretty good pitch.
You're right.
Try to get him back on your side.
I don't think he did that. Snyder sends it up in the left field, but well within range of Hill coming in for the ball and taking it. Stieb takes another no-hit bid to the ninth inning here in Cleveland. We'll be right back to you on Blue Jays Baseball on CTV. Stewart and bowling at Cleveland Stadium this beautiful Labor Day weekend Sunday afternoon. The Toronto Blue Jays leading the Indians 2-0, trying to sweep the series. Dave Stieb, one more time, taking a bid for a no-hitter to the ninth inning.
I think the other exciting fact of this ball game is that there's so many Blue Jays fans here at Cleveland. Having made the trip down for the weekend, just waving at my boys from Mississauga down here.
We're wearing a Ranger hockey sweater.
Don't go. Stieb has a no-hitter going.
McGriff ducks away from below one. He homered Hale and Bohr 1-3. It was his 30th of the year. Carrasco continues to work for the Indians. By McGriff 2-0.
I think a lot of players can learn something last night watching Fred McGriff hit against the knuckleball pitcher, Tom Candiotti. He has a good approach to that type of pitcher.
3-0.
Obviously, he's more comfortable with Fred because he normally has the spread out stance, but there are some hitters who, against the knuckleball pitcher, will spread out a little bit further than they normally do. Cut down a little bit on the stride. Chance to see some fastballs from Orozco once Orozco fell behind. Watch his power. Leaning back, not coming up too much with the upper body, and good extension. He knew all the way that that one was gone.
And so is Orozco.
So it will be Steve Olin, who was warming up earlier, coming into the game.
Right-hander, third pitcher of the afternoon, McNamara's Indians. Olin called up last July for the end of the season, the end of July, getting 23 saves, leading the Pacific Coast League in Colorado. Then he struggled and has made his team again this year. Performing in a somewhat spotty Cleveland bullpen here in 1990. 4.14 earned run average. He'll warm up, and we'll take a trip down the SO Road to Excellence. The SO Road to Excellence with Tommy Hutton, Major League player and broadcaster.
When you're keeping score of a ball game, have you ever wondered why when a pitcher strikes a hitter out, you mark a K in your scorebook? The reason is, back in 1868, a New York sports writer by the name of M.J. Kelly was devising a system of keeping score. He decided to use the letter K because it was the last letter of the word struck. Now, his first thought was to use an S, but he didn't want people to confuse it with sacrifice or stolen base or shortstop. So he went with the K. Next time Dave Stieb K's an opposing hitter, think about that on the road to excellence.
Well, we have had several of those thoughts this afternoon. Eight of them, as a matter of fact, for Dave Stieb.
Yeah, eight times we've been able to put that K down there. And we've got to get back to Freddie McGriff. as Dave Stieb just sits there and thinks. No one's going to talk to him right now. But Freddie, with that home run, the way he has performed over the last months of the season, he hasn't gotten a lot of help, especially the last week or so, from Kelly Gruber. George Bell's been out of the lineup. A lot of clubs have been pitching around him. If you remember that Boston series, they did not want to be hurt by Fred McGriff. They pitched around him a lot.
Pat Borders drives a shot with a gap. Coming over to cut it off is Deion James. He can't handle the ball. Borders hesitates, then will head for second base safely. He'll probably give James an error. Borders stopping content with a single. James had trouble with the ball. He took one more base.
Yeah, Pat was really content, and I question his thought there, because the ball was into the gap, because James is a left-handed thrower, had to backhand that ball. Pat was really content with the single, and once he saw the ball bobble, instead of taking that big aggressive turn, once he saw it bobble, then he took off for second.
That's how they scored, single and an error to the left fielder on the extra lead. So he's the second, nobody out for Glenn Allen Hill. He's lead 3-0, side arm roll, and gets it right back to Ron Hill, but over to third, pulls Borders. Third time today with one out, the Jays have a runner at third base.
Or at least on the front end of this play, three times, as you mentioned, the Jays have been able to move that runner from second to third.
And Williams, today's center fielder, takes a high ball one. No one doesn't walk on that. He's walked just 18 while striking out 45, about 64 innings of work.
Normally, Cito Gasson might make a move here to bring on a left-hander to try to get this run. But I think Cito wants to keep his best defensive club in the lineup.
Knocked down by Baerga, and he takes care of Kenny Williams. Two outs. So again, the Jays fail to capitalize with a fly ball release to score a man with one out from third.
Ball hit hard by Kenny, but a good play by Baerga. And what Cito's thinking, he's thinking ahead. And he knows that by leaving Kenny Williams in the lineup, even though he almost comes through and picks up the RBI here, if not from Baerga, by leaving Williams in the lineup, he has a good defensive outfield with Hill, Williams, and right field, Junior Felix. So some good speed out there.
This is Manny Lee. He drove into Jay's second run with a double in the fifth inning on the heels of a two-base hit by Williams.
Steve, you go back to those first two innings. He walked the leadoff man. Alex Cole was thrown out by Pat Borders. And then with two out in the second inning, he was upset with himself and walked by Carlos Baerga. But again, he was helped out by Borders as Baerga was caught trying to steal.
Eight this year. Alhada, the most recent of the Phillies, a couple of weeks ago. We had the good fortune to televise one of those from the Sky Dome, and Dave Stewart, who hit the Jays, and Dave Stieb do it this afternoon for the ninth of 1990. It is the fourth time in his magnificent career that Stieb has taken a no-hitter in the ninth inning, the second time here in Cleveland. Chris James hitting for Tom Brookins. Ball one.
And James, normally the everyday player, a 300 hitter.
Ball on the strike to him. Steve has out eight. None since the sixth inning when he fanned the side. He's done that twice today.
The position he's in. The hitter's coming off the bench. They're fresh. They've been watching him the entire game.
James gets a piece.
And through it all, think about the thoughts going through Pat Porter's head. He's never handled a no-hitter in the major leagues. So a lot of pressure on that man right there as well.
No Blue Jay catcher ever has. Last inning or so, and Dave has missed. He has been on the high side, in fact, getting higher and higher as he goes along. James into left field. Tracking over is Glenn Allen Hill. There is room. There's the out. One gone. The last three outs have been by Hill. And here are no hitters in 1990.
People remember the Nolan Ryan. Leo Perez's was a shortened no-hitter, a rain-shortened game. You know, I look back at this ball game, and there really hasn't been a tough play. Most of the eight strikeouts, most of the outs have been routine variety.
Here is the power of Candy Maldonado, a 76 RBI man for the Indians. He takes a wild swing at strike one. Joel Skinner, 3-0 Cleveland. Or 3-0 Toronto in Cleveland, up with the face of Maldonado. 1-1.
You're just excited, too.
It really is exciting. You don't get this opportunity.
You do not.
Very often.
Dave still hitting spot, so Porter's outside. Wanted the pitch there, Dave gave it to him. Dave Pat saying, keep it down.
And he chucks it by, 2-2.
It's good to see Pat Porter's back there taking charge in that manner. He's into this too. He's boasting to Dave, who you pointed out has had a few pitches up. He said, keep that ball down.
Porter's has become a very, very good catcher.
Pressure on everybody. The defense, the infielders, the outfielders. The outfielders don't want to not pick up a ball, hit their direction, and misplay it. The infielders want to handle ground balls.
There is pressure on everybody. And Blue Jay color is right here. Pitch thrown by Stieb becomes the second out. Way up in his face, he swings through it.
Not exactly where Dave wanted it because Pat had set up outside, but he ran the fastball up and in and got Maldonado to chase it.
So for the fourth time, he takes it to this stage. Two out of the ninth inning for the second time here in Cleveland. Alex Cole, the scheduled hitter from center field, will face him. He has twice grounded out, and he has walked today. And Stieb starts in with ball one.
To be alive for a bunt because he has tremendous speed.
He showed bunt on the second pitch the last time he was up, and then pulled back with it. Ball two. He's walked three this afternoon. Cole was one of them to start the ball game. Two are going to raise pot stealing. Thank you.
Fortunately, the Blue Jays have enough of a lead. We talked about it before with Phelps at first base. Now, Cole is at first, the speedster, but Trent McGriff, because the Jays have a 3-0 lead, is going to play back to fill up that hole with the lefty up there.
Ball one. Stieb in search of control at this critical juncture has thrown five balls in a row.
But I'd already thought about it, so that was that, and I just kept going at it like with the ninth inning. I thought about that the seventh, and I went after like it was the ninth. I did the same thing in the eighth, and then the ninth inning, I didn't want to make any bad pitches and let them beat me on that, so I was very careful with Cole there. And luckily, last guy hit the ball right to where I killed him.
Dave, I thought that Cole was your toughest out in the ball game. It seemed to me you pitched him a little more carefully than the others, didn't you?
Yeah, I did. I was concerned about him before I went out for the ninth inning. He takes a lot of pitches. If I got behind him, then I'd have to give in to him. And, you know, it's a good shot to get the fastball, get the base hit. But, I walked him, and I got the next guy out.
It's almost like you played it the right way by walking Cole.
Yeah, it turned out that way.
It sure enough did. Let's talk about, the night here in Cleveland with the Franco getting the hit off and all those things in the past. You're looking at 20 games this year. I mean, this is Dave Stieb's year. There's no question about it.
Well, I don't know about all that, Fergie. Right now, I'm looking at number 18, personally. It's been a great year. I've had some good play behind me, and they've scored some runs for me, and I've had a good bullpen behind me. And, I'd like to go out there and pitch a few more innings than I have, but, that's just the way the season's gone for me.
What about that shot that Phelps ripped foul off here? That was close.
Yeah, it was very close.
What did you throw?
It was a breaking ball slider in. But I didn't get in far enough, obviously. But, he was looking for something in. That's why he hit it foul.
And you were pitching into hitters all day long, it looked like, and getting ahead on the count.
Not from the get-go, I wasn't. I was behind a lot of hitters. And they swung at some bad pitches for me, and I was able to get a few strikeouts that way. But I was struggling early on, and luckily they didn't get to me, and I was able to work things out.
It was interesting. Tommy Hutton had a conversation with you in the clubhouse before the game, and you were telling him that your biggest concern here this afternoon was your release point.
Yeah, that's what I was working on in the beginning of the game. I was struggling with my release point and trying to throw pitches inside and get the breaking balls inside of left-handers. I've been struggling with that, and that's one thing that I wanted to go out there and concentrate on tonight, but I wasn't really doing it right off the bat. That's why I was struggling so much. But like I said, they swung at some bad pitches, and I stayed out of trouble because of that, and I was able to work out of it.
Dave, you've had a sensational career with Toronto. This is a moment you'll never, ever forget.
That's right, forget I won't.
And you've had five cracks at it. You got it.
That many? Oh, jeez.
All right. Well, you got a lot of other reporters. Look at the crowd here behind you. All these Toronto fans here. Look at them. The fan club is sensational.
All right, Dave Stieb.